Good morning, church. We welcome you this morning. Will you stand and sing with us as we head into this week of the Thanksgiving season? We just want to sing our thanks to the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Church of Chapel Hill. We're so glad you're here to worship with us this morning. Let's go ahead and jump into our memory verse, if that's available. Would you say this with me? Here we go. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. I have just a few announcements today, and then we'll pray for the offering and we'll pray for the message. Next Sunday is the last day. So next Sunday is the last day, deja vu, to turn in your personalized Christmas invitations for the parade. Lindsay did a great job explaining those, and so everyone should know about them. They're available in the back. If you want to write a note to somebody, pray over that card, turn it in. Next week is the final day, so please grab those and do that. If anyone wants to walk in the Christmas parade, so not only can you fill out the personal invitation, you can walk and pass out those invitations. You need to let Lindsay know today So if you want to walk in the parade, please see Lindsay and let her know. I was also asked to remind you that the Christmas banquet sign-up is back at the Connection Center. So if you are interested in the Christmas banquet, please sign up in the back at the Connection Center. I see that Pastor John is preaching from the Book of Psalms today. Many of you who know me may find this hard to believe. That is my favorite book in the Bible. Whether it is when David is just pouring out his heart to the Lord through no fault of his own, because King Saul is trying to kill him, and he's just begging the Lord for protection and strength, or when David has made some serious mistakes in his life, and he's crying out to the Lord for forgiveness when he finally comes to his senses. I love how raw and how just real the book of Psalms is. So I'm excited to hear what Pastor John is going to bring today. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we pray for the message and we pray for the offering. Would you bow with me? Father, we come to you this morning so thankful for your word, Lord, and just how real and raw it is. And you take all the human emotions that we feel, whether it's David being pursued through no fault of his own and the king trying to kill him, or David falling on his face finally after he realizes how just completely brutal his sin was, Lord. I love the truthfulness of this book and scripture in general. Father, I pray that you would be with John today as he brings this message of thankfulness, Lord. Something that I think we all fail to do on the level that we should is bring our thankful, just our adoration to you, Lord, because you are so worthy. Father, I pray that you would bless the offering as your people continue to give, be it online or dropping the offering in the plates, Lord. Bless them for it. We're not a name it and claim it church, Lord, but I pray that you would bless them for their obedience, Lord, be it in giving or being here at church or opening your word. And Father, we ask all of these things in the powerful, holy name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I'm not going to take that personally. He was trying to take my mic from me. This morning, Pastor John's going to be preaching on our wonderful Lord, and so I'm going to sing about that. He promised us that he would be a counselor, a mighty God and the Prince of Peace. He promised us that he would be a father, and he would love us with a love that would not cease. Well, I've tried him and I've found his promises are true. He is everything that he said that he would be. The finest words I know could not begin to tell just what Jesus really means to me. For he's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. He's everything that my soul ever longed for. Oh, he's everything he promised. And so much more, he's more than amazing, more than marvelous, more than miraculous, oh, more than wonderful, he's more than wonderful. That's what Jesus is to me. Stand amazed just to think that this King of glory
We come to live within the heart of man, and I marvel just to know he really loves me. When I think of who he is and who I am, for he's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. Well, he's everything that my soul ever longed for. He's everything he promised and so much more. He's more than that's what Jesus is. Oh, that's what my Jesus is. That's what Jesus is. That's what he is to me.
Stand with us.
Woo, my hands are sweaty right now. I am so moved. I'm telling you, if you could see what we see from up here, I mean, Jesus has my skin just on fire right now. But I tell you what, the message that he gives, there were so many children out here with their hands up. I my heart was just overflowing. We went and saw the first couple episodes of The Chosen. And just this morning, I was just awed, you know, saying, Jesus, just keep bringing those people in, The doors were open. People just kept coming in and coming in. And it was just like that Sermon on the Mount where, you know, all the people were excited. And I am so excited to hear the message this morning, just like they were, and just every week, just to get filled up with the messages that the Lord brings to us. Just amazing. Amen. So, let's be thankful this morning.
All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah. You get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause we've got a lion inside.
We'll dismiss our children ages 4 to 12 to Kids Church. Ages 3 and under are dismissed to the nursery. As they go out, let's just continue praising the Lord.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a
Since you're up, why don't you remain standing and turn to Psalm 111. You talk about a setup for the scripture. I'm just so grateful for the expression of worship that we have experienced this morning. And I give thanks to the Lord. Psalm 111, verse 1, praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation. The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. He has given food to those who fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant. He has declared to his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are verity and justice. All his precepts are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness. He has sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. His praise endures forever and ever and ever and ever. And all of the redeemed say, amen. And Father, we thank you. We give you thanks. Lord, as we sang, we just want to express our gratitude with humble hearts that you are gracious. You are full of compassion. Lord, I didn't want to hardly stop singing today. You're just so amazing, so marvelous, so wonderful. And so today, on this Thanksgiving Sunday, Lord, more than food, more than family, more than sweet fellowship, Lord, may we turn our eyes upon Jesus. And look full, not be distracted, not, Lord, but look fully to really see you today for who you are. And when we look full into your wonderful face, the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of your glory and grace. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for such special, sweet times. Thank you for causing our eyes and our hands to sweat this morning, being touched by the power of the Lord. And may it continue. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated, please. Lindsay, I don't know if you're in here, but I'm looking for the clicker. Anybody? Oh, here it is. I got it. By the way, it's so good to see Lee and Krista Bowens and their family back from South Carolina. So, welcome them. Make sure you grab them and hug them. And so good to have them. Also, I failed Thursday night. We had a great praise and pie service, and just thankful for the praises that went up. And but thank you to Nina, Boucher and Koki and all those who took care of us by serving us and getting everything ready. And there were many more besides those two, but thank you, Nina. And I felt bad Thursday night. I went home and I thought, well, man, I failed there. So thank you for that, and thank you for all those who participated in that. Well, this psalm that we have just read, we don't know who wrote it. We don't know the author, but it is believed to have been written soon after Israel had been set free from 70 years of slavery and captivity and exile in Babylon in the year 538 BC. And they returned to Jerusalem. And upon being set free and sent back home, the psalmist here gives thanks to God for the Lord's works. I don't know if you noticed, but the word works is mentioned five times in this psalm in verses 2, 3, 4, 6, and 7. And today, as we've sang about redemption, read about salvation, prayed and thanked God for His grace and His forgiveness and His kindness, this psalm is just overflowing with God's works and God's wonderful, great, and mighty works. And so I hope that you will get a little bit of that in your heart and in your soul today. And I want to just say three things from this scripture. We're not going to cover the whole chapter today. But the first thing I want to say on this Thanksgiving Sunday is we ought to give thanks to the Lord in our worship. And boy, have we done that already today. There are two main types of worship that the psalmist mentions here. The first is personal worship, and then the second is public worship. I want you to look again at verse 1. It says, praise the Lord, exclamation point. I always get excited when I see an exclamation point in the scripture. Extra emphasis, praise the Lord, I, that's singular, that's personal, I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. So it's not just personal worship, but it is all in personal worship. Ever gone to a game and the crowd is just half in, and the team is just playing at half capacity, and they are low energy, and you're just like, should have stayed home. But David again and again and again and again says, with my whole heart, with my whole heart, I will serve the Lord. With my whole heart, I will sing to the Lord. With my whole heart, I will serve the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise the Lord. I just tell you, there's nothing like coming to church on a Sunday morning with the people of God when you can sense the presence and the power of God, and the people are all in. We've had that this morning, to the point where your hands are sweating and your heart is pumping. And the girls down here are dancing. I walked over while we were singing. I told John Whidbey, I said, we need to get them girls some ribbons. You know, there's those twirling things. And it's all in worship with this psalmist. He said, I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. So it's personal, private worship. It's It's where no one else sees, but it's between you and the Lord. So I want to ask you this morning as we get into this Thanksgiving week, how is your private worship? How is your personal worship? How is the secret place? How is your closet? Have you, in any time recently, opened the door and worshiped the Lord, just him and you? You're not trying to get. You didn't come with your gripe list or your wish list. You came with your praise list. You said, Lord, I'm just here to express to you my gratitude and my thanksgiving and my worship and my praise, and you're worthy and you receive all the glory. How long has it been since you just knelt down and you have actually just had some tears at the thought that you've prayed this prayer and said, thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for my sin of unbelief. And you came in and I placed my faith in you, and you redeemed me, and you washed me white as snow, and the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, has cleansed me from all sin. How long has it been since you've done that? Just you and Jesus. And it's not a show. You're not out, and nobody can hear. It's just you and the Lord. How long has it been since your heart has pumped vigorously in your personal devotions? How long has it been since you've got on the floor and your hands have sweated when you aren't with anybody else? And that's what the psalmist is saying here. He said, I will praise the Lord. And man, my heart is in it. This isn't out of duty today. This is out of sheer delight and thanksgiving to the Lord. Max Lucado, who many of us have read over the years, said this: when our deepest desire is not the things of God or a favor from God, but God himself, we cross a threshold. We cross a threshold. And if you say, man, I'm just struggling in my relationship with the Lord, more than likely, it's because you are not being renewed day by day by day. You say, I come to church and it's just kind of, I'm half in. I'll tell you why. It's because more than likely, you're 1/3 or you're 1/8 or you're 1/16th in your personal time with the Lord. And if you will begin to seek the Lord in personal worship, you will find that when you cross the threshold into the church, it's a totally different experience. But you must learn and grow to seek the Lord on your own in private and personal worship to the Lord. I love Acts chapter 4, verse 13. It says this. You don't have to turn there, but it just says, now when they saw the boldness, these lost people saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled. So Peter and John were sharing the gospel. They were talking about Jesus and giving the good news. And these people were going, good night. I mean, they don't have the right, this isn't like a liturgical, intellectual, deep speech like we usually hear from some of the rabbis. Like these guys, they don't have a great vocabulary. They're using very common words. But man, when they speak, it's different. It's got the power of Yahweh on it. They're uneducated, they're untrained, they haven't been to seminary, but then listen what it says. They marveled because they realized that Peter and John had been with Jesus. And I'll give good news for some of you dads and you moms. Your kids aren't looking for you to be able to answer all their questions. Your son's dad and your daughter's mom, they need to just be able to look at you when they've got up late, knowing that you've been up early, and they can say, Daddy's been with Jesus. He's talking different. Mommy's been with Jesus. Her mood's different. You've been with Jesus. Give thanks to the Lord in our personal worship. There is no substitute for the secret place. None. Pastor John, Pastor Dan, Pastor Gary, Lindsay, Tom, Donna, the praise team cannot produce and give to you what God can give to you Monday through Saturday. Personal worship. And then we must give thanks to the Lord in our public worship. Look at verse 1 again. It says, praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly. Now, this isn't the full congregation. This is in the assembly. This is This is more of a small group. I'm assembling together. This is Hebrews 10:25. Do not forsake getting together, all the more. But then he says, in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation. So he's coming together in fellowship with the people of God throughout the week, and they're coming together on the Lord's Day as a congregation and as a flock. So there's personal worship, all in personal worship, and then there is public worship, all together public worship. And that's why I'm just so grateful to see you this morning. I tell you, when I walked in this morning and I saw some of your faces, I just, with most of you, I was just so excited. And I really was, all of you. Just so grateful to have all together public worship in the assembly and with the congregation. John Phillips, wonderful preacher that has taught me so many things. He wrote in his commentary on this portion of scripture. He said, private worship lifts public worship to new heights. In public worship, the Holy Spirit blends together the music of many different human instruments, orchestrating the whole into a euphonious blending of joy. This person brings a heart overflowing with precious thoughts of God that have blessed his or her soul in private devotions. Another, whose heart is made glad by a glorious answer to prayer, is bursting with thanks. Another has a heart made tender by deep sorrow and by the comfort of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God brings together all these colors of the spectrum of private worship and blends them into the pure white light of public worship. I love that. So my encouragement to you today is, if you want your public worship at church on Sunday to be mighty and powerful, you will receive it, not when you walk in these doors, but when you get into your secret place between you and Jesus Monday through Saturday. We had a great example this Thursday night where Phil and Shirley have been sitting over here for all these years, each of those the third Thursday night of November. This one was different. This one was heavier. This one was came with much more sorrow and pain as they lost their son Matt earlier this year. And yet Shirley grabbed the mic. I told everybody, I'll hold the mic. She didn't have that. She grabbed the mic from me and just looked at me. I'm Mother Superior. And I thought, yes, ma'am. And I just knelt down beside her. And Shirley, the tears begin to flow. And she said, I cannot express how much I am full of gratitude and thanksgiving for this body of Christ, for this church family. We could not make it alone. And we have you, and you've walked beside us through this, and we love you, and we are grateful for you, and we give praise to the Lord for our church family. So give thanks to the Lord in worship personally and then publicly, and it will change your life. Secondly, give thanks to the Lord in our wonder, in our wonder. Now look at verse 2. The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. I would love to just deliberate on the word studied for a while, but we don't have time. The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. He has made his wonderful works. Let's say those two words together. Here we go. Wonderful works. He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. Let me just give you three S words that most of the world and many of us would say would title as wonderful. The first would be sustenance, food. I went with Dad and Mom and Grace and my Uncle John. Last week, we went to Cracker Barrel. I haven't been to Cracker Barrel in a good long haul. And we went there and we got their pancakes with the maple syrup. And I got a big breakfast. I thought, I'm going to Cracker Barrel, I'm getting it on. And so I got the biscuits and the strawberry jelly and the apple butter and had scrambled eggs and grits, stole fried chicken from my daughter. I was crossing over the table. We were just, it was a buffet. It was tremendous. It was so good. Little crispy edges on the pancakes. I'm losing some of you. Stay with me, okay? You know, the thing about Cracker Barrel, though, is if you want it to sustain you, you got to go back. That only lasted me for a few hours. And Carrie was in Hawaii. So I'm digging through the leftovers that she left 4 or 5 days before, feeling sorry for myself. And the neglected boy, as my father has called me, and struggling. It didn't satisfy for the long haul. Something that is truly wonderful, it is full of wonder. The word wonderful means to astonish, to amaze, to blow it, knock your socks off. I mean, food is excellent, tremendous, but in the true sense of the word, it's really not wonderful because it doesn't last. Think of sports. Boy, that game between Tennessee and Alabama, I'm not even either of their fans, but that was great, wasn't it? I mean, it's insane watching that orange ocean come down and just tear down the field goal post. Sports mesmerizes our society. It is a little G God. I mean, it takes so much, but the Apostle Paul enjoyed sports, and I enjoyed watching the Buckeyes yesterday, and I had sweaty hands then. And I was, you know, you watch that, and it's great. It's good. It's fine. The truest sense of the word, sports is not really wonderful. Because the championship, even if you win the thing, the little golden cup or whatever is going to get broke when you have kids anyways. I mean, the thing is not going to last. It's not going to last. It's not full of wonder. It's not wonderful. It's just enjoyable and it's a blessing. What about, I'm not going to be provocative here, but the third S word is sex. Our world is a sexually saturated society. Sensual. It doesn't matter if it's the music. It doesn't matter if it's a hair advertisement. They will sensualize and sexualize everything just to get you to watch it and to buy it. I will say, as a married man, I praise the Lord for sex and for intimacy. Now listen, I'm not trying to be cute. I'm not trying to, you know, Listen, intimacy is a gift from the Lord. It is for a husband and a wife only. There is something sacred and holy. Listen, when you have your heart spiritually is connected with your spouse, and you're both loving the Lord together, and you're serving the Lord together, and you're leading your family in the fear and instruction of the Lord. And then when you have that emotional connection where you're still laughing together, you're still sitting down together and you can just talk and be friends. And you have that spiritual and then that emotional and relational. The Lord uses all of those elements to bring you together as one physically. And it's great. It is one of the prime blessings of marriage. And I praise the Lord for it. But I'll tell you, in the truest sense of the word, even the intimacy between a husband and a wife is not eternal. It won't last. It's an incredible blessing that has multiple purposes for this life. But it won't last. And we'll get old. And our bodies won't properly operate like they used to. And you lose some of the drive and you lose some of the excitement. But the Bible says here, look again at verse 4. It says, the Lord has made his works to be wonderful, full of wonder, and to be remembered, his graciousness and his compassion, and it is full compassion. And I want to just tell you today that if you want to be satisfied beyond food and the ball games and that window in your life where you have blessed intimacy, you better make sure that you find your full wonder and the wonderful blessings of life in the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what you will find is truly wonderful. John Piper said this, if you don't feel strong desires for the manifestation of the glory of God, it is not because you have drunk deeply and are satisfied. It is because you have nibbled so long at the table of the world. Your soul is stuffed with small things and there is no room for the great. I've read another excerpt, not this one, from a book called All by Paul Tripp, written in 2015. If you are half in, if you are lukewarm, if you are blasé in your walk with the Lord, I encourage you to purchase this book. It's called All, Why It Matters for Everything We Think, Say, and Do. I'll read you this short excerpt and one of the chapters, he said this, sin. So again, just keep in mind verse 4 of 1 and 11. God has made his wonderful works to be remembered. His graciousness and he's full of compassion. And the devil's constantly trying to steal that from us. So, Tripp writes this, sin makes us all God amnesiacs. In other words, we forget. And because we are, we become desperate, self-focused, unhappy, demanding, and disappointed. We have met the enemy, and it is us. And because it is, we have no power to defeat it. We will forget God. We will replace him with something else. We will place ourselves at the center. And thus, we will live driven and dissatisfied lives, self-centered and immoral in the deepest sense of both terms. This is why Jesus had to come. We needed a means by which God could forgive us for our all thievery and a means which by which God could free us from our self-slavery. And if you're struggling with the wonderful Lord and you don't see him as wonderful anymore, you need him to restore and renew and revive your all of him. That he alone is truly wonderful. There is a man that I grew up knowing. He was my grandmother's brother. His name is Ed Hughes. And here he is with Gibbs and then with my dad, Uncle Ed. Uncle Ed was a very bombastic, energetic, exciting man. Never remember, he drove an El Camino, come into the parking lot where my grandparents were staying at the parsonage, and come in and just always, and he'd get down on the ground with the kids and come here, Gibbs, and how you doing it? I mean, he was always cackling and just full of, this guy was, he was great. Loved the Lord, he just break out in song and so enjoyable. He had a wrecker service in his younger years, and I think he had 10 or 12 big wrecker trucks in Cincinnati, probably the biggest wrecker company, did very well in business. He was sharp intellectually and had a lot of employees. And so anyway, when he got into his 80s, most of his family had died off, and his children didn't live nearby, and he had been estranged from his wife, and so he was all alone in this big cement building and had all this tools and everything, and he couldn't take care of it anymore. So anyway, they got a hold of Dad, and my dad became Uncle Ed's caretaker and eventually moved him up here to Mount Vernon, short stint in Mom and Dad's house, and then to Eastern Star Nursing Home. And so we would go visit him, and I'd take the kids every once in a while. And Uncle Ed, even in his late 80s, was still energetic. As you can see there, he had lost most of his teeth, and he just had a little room, all of his tools, somebody else owned, all of the record trucks were gone, all of the money had dissipated, everything. He was just living on the kindness of Dad and the nursing home. And everything in this life that was precious to him in regards to materialism was gone. It was gone. But we would walk into his nursing home room, say, "Uncle Ed, hey, how you doing today?" And he loved the word wonderful. And he didn't just say it, he liked to sing it. So Dad would go in there, "Hi, Uncle Ed, getting along okay today?" "Wonderful, wonderful." And then he would, we would laugh. And then anytime we laughed, it didn't matter. He would just bust out laughing. And, you know, he's smiling and just a few teeth. It was beautiful. Of course, it's nursing home food. And I know they do their best in there, but it's not Cracker Barrel. Let's just be honest. And you go in there, "Hey, Uncle Ed, how's lunch today?" "Wonderful, wonderful." You know, it was awesome. His health was failing. He at times couldn't get out of bed. You'd go in there and he was bedridden. "How you doing, Uncle Ed?" "How you doing?" "Wonderful, wonderful." Uncle Ed knew the Lord Jesus. And even when he had lost everything and he had terrible dementia, he couldn't remember my name, couldn't remember Dad half the time, didn't know the nurses, couldn't remember what we were talking about the sentence before. But the Bible says God has made his wonderful works to be remembered. And Uncle Ed never forgot about Jesus. You'd go in there and start singing a hymn and just he'd match you word for word, tune. And we have videos of him sitting on the same porch with Dad singing, "I've decided to follow Jesus." And I'll just tell you, folks, it is wonderful to enter into Thanksgiving and to know that Jesus Christ lives and abides in me. There's nothing like it. Nothing like it. Give thanks to the Lord in our wonder, because he is wonderful. I want you to turn to Psalm 107. Just back four chapters. Look at this. We'll start in verse 8. Psalm 107. And we're just going to skip down through these verses, because this psalmist gets on a tangent. He says, Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Verse 15. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Verse 21. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Verse 31, I mean, he's not just saying that men, he's saying, oh, this is passion. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt him also in the assembly of the people. He is wonderful. He is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. And then, thirdly, give thanks to the Lord in our wealth. In our wealth. Look at verse 5. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. He has given food. All I have needed, his hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. He has given us food. To those who fear him, he will be ever mindful of his covenant, his promises. He has declared to his people the power of his works and giving them the heritage of the nations. I want you just to look at this praise list. The three essentials that God gives to his children that meet pretty much all of our needs from conception all the way into and through eternity. The first one he says is food. He said he's given us food. And of course, that can stand for our other material needs. The Lord said, look, I'm gonna provide you with food and clothing, and in that, be content. He said, yeah, I'm going to meet everything that you, all the needs you have. I'm going to take care of them. And then it says, look, it says, he will ever be mindful. He will never forget his covenant. He made a covenant with Abraham. And he made a covenant with Noah. And he said, I will never forget those promises. I'm going to take care of my people. I'm going to supply salvation and redemption and grace and compassion for my people. And then the third on the praise list is, it says, he has given to us the heritage of the nations. And of course, this is speaking of when the children of Israel, God sent them out to head towards the promised land, Canaan land. And he said, I've got a land flowing up for you with milk and honey and wells that you did not dig. Water's going to be there for you. Everything you need. Shelter. You're going to have your needs met. What a heritage. What an inheritance. God said, I've got an inheritance for you, Israel. And so Moses heads out. And eventually, in the book of Joshua, they cross over and they get their heritage. They get their inheritance. So here the children of Israel were in captivity in Babylon for 70 years, and the heritage that God planned for them had been taken away, and they were in captivity in Babylon. But now they're back, and they're home, and thus comes this psalm. I want to ask you this morning, do you have a heritage? Some of you don't. Some of you grew up poor, and your dad and moms could barely make it, and when they got in their earlier years, or their later years, they passed away, and you didn't get much. You got a few mementos, but you didn't have that inheritance that you see some of your friends have, and some of your coworkers get. Some of you don't have that. Some of you are, right now, your parents are still living, and that's not your testimony. Some of you do. Some of you will be very blessed one day with a heritage and an inheritance. But in this type of wealth, we're talking about a spiritual heritage. We're talking about an eternal heritage. And I want to ask you this morning, do you have a spiritual heritage? Are you spiritually wealthy? The word heritage means something that is handed down, something that comes or belongs to one by reason of birth. An inherited portion, something reserved for one, something that has been inherited by legal descent or succession, especially property and land that devolves by right of inheritance. So in the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus is talking with a very religious man named Nicodemus, and Jesus said to him, I say to you, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. The psalmist said, I was born in sin from my mother's womb. Because Adam sinned, the Bible says that all humanity is born in sin. And so God says, spiritually, you must be born again. He said to Nicodemus, man is born of water through their mother. But if you want to go to heaven and be having a spiritual salvation and inheritance, you must be born of the Spirit of God. You must be born again spiritually. I want you to turn one more scripture and we'll be done. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. If you can't get excited about anything else, I hope you get excited about this. Verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, those that have been born again, these are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children, then heirs. We have an inheritance. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. I want to ask you this morning, are you spiritually wealthy? Do you have an inheritance? Is the Lord Jesus Christ, his salvation, his forgiveness, his grace, his compassion, his full compassion, does it belong to you? Because he has adopted you as his son and as his daughter. I want to ask you this morning, do you know that you are born again? Not that some years ago you prayed a prayer or that you walked an aisle. That can be good, but that does not save you. The Bible says that if you belong to Christ, there is fruit that is produced from the Spirit of God who dwells in you. Do you know that you have eternal life? Do you know that Christ is your Savior? And if you don't, for God's sake, be saved. Come to Christ. Claim your heritage. Claim your inheritance. Be born again. Be saved. Come to Christ. Come to Jesus. It would be an awful thing to hear the word of God this morning and how wonderful Jesus is, and to walk out of those doors and head into Thanksgiving and be unsaved and be lost and be without Christ. I plead with you, don't let that be your story. If you do not know that you know that you know that Christ is your Savior, look to your right. There's an old hymn that says, on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross. I'll cherish the old rugged cross. Do you have an inheritance that will outlast this life? There are some people that are hinging their whole existence on when they finally get what belongs to their dad and their mom, or to an aunt or to an uncle. That is why they live. That is why they breathe. That is the drive of their existence. But it's not going to be wonderful, because it's not eternal and it won't last. One life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. I'd ask you to bow your heads this morning, please. And I want to ask you, are you in the family? Have you been born again of the Spirit of God? Do you know Christ as your Savior? Have you repented? The Bible says if you will repent, if you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Have you experienced that? There's nothing like it. Can you enter into this Thanksgiving knowing that everything is right between you and the Savior? We're going to sing an old hymn that says, just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. So, has the blood of Christ covered over your sins? Have you experienced, as verse 4 said, His grace and His full compassion. If not, you can do that today. I'd ask you to stand this morning. I want to just pray for you and pray over you. And if you need to come, come. Maybe you just need to come. You know the Lord. You need to give thanks. Or maybe you don't know the Lord and you need to come and give your heart to Him and be saved. I can pray with you, Pastor Dan, my mom, my wife. They'll pray with you. Father, this morning, we give thanks. We praise you, Lord Jesus, that you walked the Via Dolorosa, climbed on a cross willingly, and died. You died that we might have life. Thank you, Jesus. Oh no, the old story will never grow old. How Jesus died to save my soul. Lord, we thank you that you are wonderful. And I pray today that if there are those here who have lost the wonder, they believed on you many years ago, but their hands don't sweat anymore. Their eyes don't tear up anymore. They come to church is just because that's what we do, but they've lost the fire. They've lost the excitement. They've lost the wonder. Oh, Lord, today may they come and say, Lord Jesus, renew, revive, rekindle the fire. And then, Lord, if there are those who've never, never believed on you, I pray that they would do that this morning, that they would be saved, that they would become part of the family and have an inheritance that outlasts this life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you need to come, you come this morning. Let's sing this together. Of I Surrender All. And we don't drag out invitations here, but I just want to sing this and just ask you. My grandpa Vess used to get down on eye level and just ask his flock, is everything right between you and the Lord? Are all hearts clear? Don't enter into thanksgiving with baggage. Be able to give thanks in our worship and be able to be in wonder without things dragging behind you. So let's just sing this together.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence.
Wonderful, more than amazing, more than marvelous. All of us can sing, You are more than wonderful. And we stand amazed in Your presence. And we say, how marvelous, how wonderful. And my song shall ever be, how marvelous, how wonderful, wonderful, wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Lord, I pray today that if there is a soul here that does not know that they are right with You, that they are saved, that they would not leave this sanctuary, this building, this parking lot, Lord, I pray they'd come to me and say, I need to be saved and become part of the inheritance of eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. I got one line I want to sing with you, or one little chorus. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. And then we'll be dismissed.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountains, cleansed by His blood, joined heirs with Jesus.
To be, just saw somebody. There's going to be offering plates, and we want you to give to Operation Christmas Child. All of the boxes have been taken, but we take up a big offering every to ship them out to different parts of the world. So on your way out, this is the Sunday we give the love offering. Please give a donation, a love offering to cover the shipping. And thank you for doing the boxes. We got rid of all of them, and so thank you for your giving. Love being part of the family. Fellowship with one another. You're dismissed. Happy Thanksgiving.